Yeah, so a very good afternoon, Ahmedabad, the smart city of Gujarat. Thank you so very much for inviting me here to speak on this topic. So a little bit about myself. It's not working. Yeah, so a little intro about myself. My name is Kapil Bakshi and I work as a software engineer at Blackbuck. So Blackbuck, so you know, we are a startup, you know, solving problems in logistics in India. It's a big problem, you know, moving freight from one place to another, and we are trying to solve it as efficiently as possible. And with that, I have experience in logistics, fintech and edtech sectors. And apart from my work, I am a big time foodie. I love traveling, that is why I'm here. And I'm a music lover, and I watch and I like watching suspense movies. You can follow me on Twitter. My handle is akapil167, and my email ID is kapilbakshi167@gmail.com. And I am from New Delhi, the capital of India, but living in Bangalore since the past 1.5 years. So let's get to the topic. The major release is coming, and the bugs come with it. The war is between the features and the bugs. And make no mistake, for the bugs are coming. And that is why we have gathered here, you know, to find a solution to it. So let's get the work done. Ahmedabad, the smart city of Gujarat, are you with me?
Yes.
Cool. So you know, this talk will clear all your confusions. So when you think of testing, automated testing, you know, a lot of confusions come in your mind as to, you know, which framework to choose, how to write testable code in the first place, and running tests on multiple devices, and then unit testing, instrumentation testing, or end-to-end test. We'll, you know, take into account each one of these problems and try to find a solution to them. So before, you know, diving in to different approaches of testing, let's first of all focus on the basic guidelines of testing. So this we call testing pyramid, and this forms the basic, you know, of testing, you know, and this forms the basis. So what this pyramid says is that, you know, your unit test should be at the bottom. That means they should be the fundamental blocks of your testing, of your test suite, and they should be in abundance. There should be a lot of unit tests, you know, and then more priority should be given to integration tests and then to end-to-end test. We'll see why I'm saying that. We'll see with the help of some scenarios. And the tools available to unit test your app are Robolectric, you know, and JUnit. And you know, you can also use Mockito to mock the dependencies. And the idea of unit test is to test your core business logic, right? We'll see everything in detail. And then, you know, the next approach should be on integration test and then on end-to-end test. Okay, so before starting, you know, before diving a little more deep, I would like to tell you about what flakiness is. So what flakiness means is, you know, you have the same code, you have the same testing code, and that would fail sometimes, and that would also pass sometimes. It would fail because, you know, your tests are depending on some external dependencies, like for the network, you know, or some Android-specific things. And they may not be the same, right? They may work sometime, they may not work on sometime. And that we call as flakiness. And flakiness is a very big hindrance to testing your apps. We'll see, and then to mitigate flakiness, what we have is called hermetic approach. We have hero hermetic to the rescue, which, you know, focuses on mocking all the dependencies. You should not depend on the external dependencies, you know. Your code should be sufficient enough to mock all those scenarios, rather than, you know, depending on network or, you know, for other Android APIs, right? Because the network may not work properly, the server may not, it may work differently for different scenarios, right? So the idea is to mock as many dependencies as possible and rely more on unit tests. So unit tests versus end-to-end tests, what are the differences between the two? Unit tests are fast. As you know, because they do not depend on external dependencies. They test your code in isolation. They are much more focused towards your code, right? And they're more reliable. They test your features in isolation, right? They test your code more reliably. We'll see that, you know, everything in action. Just, you know, this is just to give you a brief guideline as to what is the difference between the two. But, you know, an end-to-end test, indeed, it mocks the real user because we are depending on the real, on the dependencies. So that is an advantage of end-to-end tests as compared to unit tests. So now really, let's talk about the scenarios, right? Pay attention to it, the scenarios. So let's say, for example, you know, you want to test the errors. Let's say the internet is not connected. Or let's say, you know, there's some error from the server. Now, if you don't automate it, or your code is not, you know, capable enough to, you know, inject these scenarios, would you ask your, you know, manual tester to again and again test it, right? Would you ask the manual manual QA engineer to turn off the internet and then turn it off and then see whether, you know, this method is coming or not? What if you have an automated pipeline? How exactly will you test these scenarios if you don't follow unit testing? Right? I hope you're getting what I'm trying to say. Right? And yeah. So, you know, that defeats the purpose of automation altogether. So, the only thing is your code should be capable enough to inject all those scenarios. Right? So that, you know, you don't require any manual intervention for that. And then we have another scenario. So, you know, consider an app, you know, which has many orders like Flipkart or be it any other app, Food Panda or all, and any other app. So these may have different, an order can have different status, right? An order can be under processing state, under dispatch state. And for an order, you know, to move from one state to another, there's a lot of stuff happening at the back end. So what if you want to test orders, you know, let's say, you know, so for example, if the order is in dispatch state, I would click on this order and I should be redirected to the page which corresponds to dispatched order state, right? And so let's see what would happen if we don't test it hermetically. What would happen is, so you know, for an order to move, you know, in different states, we have the app from where the customer places the order. We have different dashboards for different, you know, for different stakeholders of the company. Like for example, you know, there would be a person in that company's team which would, you know, move your order from this state to another, from processing state, you know, to order dispatched, right? Because he'll validate the order. And for that, and also to deliver the app, your delivery boy has the app. So that, you know, migrating of order statuses from one status to another, that is not in your hands. There are different APIs, different dashboards for that, right? And so if you want to test these scenarios, you have to hit those external APIs, which do not belong to your app and do not belong to you, first of all, right? So many developers, what they do is, you know, they try to go for the end-to-end test. And when scenarios like these come, you know, then you are doomed altogether. You try, you know, to hit those APIs, and then your test, you know, the time of your test increases. And what happens is that you'll realize that, you know, you're taking much longer to make arrangements to write test cases than to actually write test cases, right? So if you're hitting the dashboard API, moving order from one state to another, that is not your job. That is not the code you've written, right? Your testing should focus on what you've written, right? Not, you know, focusing on making arrangements to write test cases, moving order from, you know, dispatch to processing, and then checking whether, you know, it's working properly or not. That is a very cumbersome process. So that is why, you know, unit testing and testing, you know, in a hermetic environment is very important. Right? And then you'll also realize, you know, that it's taking much longer to write test cases than to develop the features. Right? And as I already told, you're testing what you haven't even written. Right? And the goal of testing gets farther and farther away. Right? And that is what happens. So the solution is, you know, it's quite simple. Let the code take control of everything. Your code should be configurable enough and testable enough that you can mock or inject these scenarios without, you know, doing some manual intervention or, you know, following end-to-end tests or, you know, having some flakiness in your tests. And how we'll do this, you know, let's see this, let's explore how. So first of all, we have something called repository pattern. So what repository pattern does is, so you have your domain layer or the business logic, you have your data layer from where you fetch the data, And in between these two, you have a repository. The work of the repository, you know, is to get the data from different sources. Data sources can be different, right? The data can come from the cloud, it can come from your local storage, and for testing, you know, it can come from the mock data source, which you have mocked actually. The only thing is the repository ensures that the contract by which, you know, you are fetching the data, that remains the same. So that it's easier for you to interchange the data source, but have the contract same. So get orders, it will give you a list of orders. But you know, your business logic, your domain layer doesn't know that from where the data will come from. It's the repository which will, you know, decide which data source to choose. And that this, you know, it makes our code much more configurable, right? So other advantages of a repository pattern is that it provides abstraction of data. You know, you don't have to worry about where the data is coming from. The business logic or the domain layer doesn't need to worry about where the data is coming from. It's a repository's responsibility. And you know, the code also becomes highly maintainable and extensible. So what if, you know, today you're using Volley, tomorrow you might use Retrofit, right, to fetch data from the server. Or for that matter, today you're using SQLite, tomorrow you may use Room. So what you'll do is you'll make a different data source, you'll make a change in the data source, and the business logic wouldn't have to worry about it, right? And that is how you can make your code extensible and maintainable as well, right? So let's have a sample, right? So as I spoke about my order app example, so this is an interface which is orders data source, and this interface would be implemented by all the data sources such that the contract remains the same. This method right here, get orders response, that will be implemented by all those data sources, right? And so this is my repository. My repository will accept a data source, and with the help of that data source, I'll be fetching, you know, the data. And via the callback method, which was the callback interface here, I'll communicate it back to my view model or my business logic. Yeah, so this is my orders data source. In this data source, I'm fetching the data from the cloud directly. This is the get orders response. So this is the repository right now. Yeah, this is the repository, and this is my orders data source. So have a look at the highlighted portion. The get, like I already told you, it's implementing the orders data source, and it's, you know, it's also overriding the get orders response method. And now what it does is, this data source, it takes data from Retrofit, and via callback, it's giving data to the view model, right? I hope you understand it. Right. And so this is my fake data source. It is also implementing the orders data source, but what it's doing is it's fetching data from my fake repository. And this orders data source has different methods to, you know, create this orders response in accordance with different scenarios. Actually, we'll see it how. So this is the basic method which will create the response, which will mock the response for you. It will, you know, accept what is to be displayed. So you can pass a Boolean variable success whether the response is successful or not. You can pass the error message if the response contains any error message, and you can pass the order list which you are sending to the server, which you are sending to the user. So just see, you know, how configurable the code becomes. Now me as a coder, as a developer, can mock different scenarios. I can pass success false here, I can pass the error message, and bingo, you know, I have replicated the scenario wherein there's an error, right? And see how is it happening, we'll see in the code. So this is a method which creates orders as per different statuses. What if you know, there can be hundreds of statuses in your app. You can, you know, pass a list of all the statuses, and that response would be created for you. And then you can pass an error message, right? And the response would be created for you with an error, right? And similarly, when there's a whenever there's an exception, you know, so what happens? So there's this on error callback method in your Retrofit or any other thing. So whenever there's no internet, or there's another, so the JSON is not valid, that method gets triggered. So I'm also, you know, replicating that, right? So now, how do we interchange the data sources, you know, while running our tests? So in my main app, you know, I want to get data from the remote server, and while testing, I want data from my mock. I want the mock data to be fetched. So how exactly we do it? So this is where dependency injection comes into picture, right? And what dependency injection is, you know, we delegate the responsibility to provide external code. The client doesn't have to build it. So for example, you know, you're depending on retrofit. Let's say a class depends on retrofit. That is not the class's responsibility to build the retrofit client, right? And what if, you know, I want something else configured to retrofit? So the responsibility should be to someone else without the client having to build those, you know, dependencies for you. And that is why we have dependency injection. And let's see how it happens. The code becomes highly configurable and reusable as, you know, we follow dependency injection. And the code also becomes decoupled, highly decoupled. So let's see how exactly Dagger 2 solves this purpose of dependency injection. So in Dagger, we have this concept of module. So what modules does is, it, you know, returns you the particular model or the source where the data would come from. So taking example of our app, of our order app, there's this method, you know, with a provides annotation here. So this will provide me a repository with, you know, with source as remote data source, this orders module, right? So if I want to, you know, get data from the remote server, I'll be using this orders remote data source in my module, and this will provide me the order repository with the orders remote data source injected into it. And there's also a test module for that. So what test module is doing is it's extending the orders module, and over here, if you see the highlighted green portion, it's accepting a fake data source, not the actual data source, right? So, you know, this is how the modules help us in getting the required data. And then what we have is called components. So components, you know, it's just like an interface. It has, you know, what all modules your app, the component would depend on. So for example, it would depend on notes module, network module, and the orders module. So ideally, what should happen is that there should be a different level. All the components should be at different levels. So for simplicity's sake, I put all these modules, you know, into one component. There's this notion of scopes, you know, and subcomponents. So at the app component, it should only, you know, focus on modules which are required at the app level. Let's say, you know, the remote data source or retrofit or the context of the app. All these entire things, you know, like the orders module, which are specific to, you know, particular screens or particular thing, they should be in a different component. But for simplicity's sake, I've put in the same component. So this is how the injection takes place, actually. In your application class, you have this method called getComponent, and what the component does is it's getting built up here, and it's accepting the modules. So which all modules, you know, the component would have, and then, you know, it will give you the components. And how exactly these components are used in your activity class, this we'll see here. Yeah. And yes, so, you know, while writing test cases, so if you look at the green highlighted portion, we have used orders test module instead of using the actual module. That is, you know, we are configuring, or, you know, we are interchanging the sources exactly. So let's, you know, have a look at our activity, how exactly the injection is taking place in the activity. What you do is, with the inject annotation, you declare this variable orders repository, and then in your onCreate method, you get the component we created in application, and you call the inject method. So automatically, you know, it'll inject that particular order repository here. So as in our main app, we are running only the main application. That is why our remote orders data source would get injected here, right? So we'll be dealing with the actual resource, not the mocked data resource. And then let's have a look at a view model, right? So a view model is accepting the repository, and the view model, you know, it's being called from your activity or your view. And then if you see here at the bottom here, the repository is calling, you know, the get orders response, which, you know, and this method corresponds to the order data source interface which you created earlier. So that is making sure that the contract remains the same. You know, the data source can be any. And the data source, you know, that is coming from a configuration which I've given at the application level. So the job of the view model, you know, it's actually to communicate with my repository, which I spoke about in the repository pattern, and just get the data out. And the repository itself is deciding as to what data source to choose, right? That is how, you know, we are making our code much more configurable. Yeah, so, and this is the method which gets called whenever you call get orders. So since I'm using Rx Java, so there's this on error method and on next method. So, and what the data sources are giving us, they are giving us an observable of you know, of all the orders. So be it data coming from my mock data source or be it data coming from a remote data source, this contract would be the same, this observable would be the same. And this is, you know, what is being handled in my view model. So whenever some error occurs, I'm, you know, so these are observables. Data loading is an observable. We'll come to it later. So, you know, I'm throwing a snack bar text as to this, as to, you know, this error occurred. And then at the bottom here, you know, I'm informing my activity, you know, that the orders list is loaded. So you load this, you know, into your recycler view or something. So orders list is also an observable. It's not, it's not an array list, and we'll see how exactly, you know, it's being communicated to the activity via the observer pattern later. So here, just understand, you know, that using the repository pattern and dependency injection, we are, you know, mocking different data sources. We are depending on different data sources. We are configuring it, right, on the basis of the configuration. So, you know, now that we have our tools ready, we know what repository pattern means and what dependency injection means. So, you know, let's start writing test cases. So, you know, these are the three approaches I'll be covering: writing unit instrumentation and integration testing using Espresso, unit testing using Robolectric, and, you know, pure JVM testing using model view, view model, or MVVM. And, you know, you'll get answers to your questions, you know, which one to choose. And you'll also get, you know, the performance analysis of these two methods. So why Espresso? You know, you have different integration tests, you know, UI testing frameworks available for you. Then why choose Espresso? The first reason is that it's closely integrated with Android Studio. It's very much integrated, you know, with the Android code. And no external dependency, you know. For example, you know, in case of Appium, if you use Appium, you know, you have to configure the Appium server, you know, and it's a very long process for you. So Espresso comes in very handy with Android Studio. That is one of the reasons to use it. Another reason is that, you know, it can be used both for unit testing and integration testing, right? So it's the Espresso knows, you know, you can it's focused more on white box testing than black box testing. And the other thing is, you know, that it removes flakiness, what I told about, by mocking some Android-specific things. So this is what I call hypnotic effect of Espresso intents. So, you know, what if, you know, you want to test, and in between something comes up, you know. So if you would have used, you know, Appium or something like that, you can, you know, using UI Automator, you can extract IDs. So a camera app is also an app. So when you open the camera app, the button by which you click the photograph, that has an ID associated with it. So you have this framework called UI Automator, by which, you know, you can test on different apps, and, you know, you can try finding out the IDs of what the ID of that button was. So, but the thing is that the button of that camera app, let's say for Samsung app, there would be a different ID. On the Samsung phone, the camera app would have a different button ID. And let's say, you know, for Lenovo or other phone, that would have a different ID. So, you know, I can't go about, you know, changing the ID of the buttons, right? So that is why Espresso provides a very handy way of mocking these Android specific things, right? So that is how it removes flakiness. And another big advantages of Espresso is that, you know, it lets you record the test cases. So what you do is you start interacting with your app, and whenever you click a button, the test code for that would automatically get generated for you. You don't have to write test code for that. But it does have some limitations, the test recorder feature. Like there are limited number of assertions and cannot handle UI actions on other apps. So let's say, for example, in your app, you have, Paytm gateway integrated, Paytm SDK integrated. So if you click on the Paytm specific UI, that won't be recorded, right? So now to write instrumentation test cases are test cases which run on a real device. And for that, you know, you have this a different source set. So if you see your package, your Android source package, you would find this folder called Android test. So this is where, your entire instrumentation test code resides. So this is what it is. And so before setting up, before writing instrumentation test cases, what we'll do is, in our Gradle file, we'll have an instrumentation runner. We'll have a custom instrumentation runner, and that we'll declare in our instrumentation test runner in the Gradle file. And what this runner would do is that we have this test application, right? So instead of me running the main application, I'll be using the test application. So this is what the runner would do. And what does this test application do? So well, it'll use the mocked modules, the test modules. It won't use the actual modules, which are giving me data from the actual remote resource. These modules, as we saw in the previous slides, these would give me data from my mocked data source, not from the actual data source. So, that is how, we are configuring our code, to support different data sources. Like this is how we are interchanging different data sources, right? So like Espresso commands, I'll give you a brief overview. So we have three, main components to write test cases in Espresso. One is view matcher. So what view matcher does is, it finds the view for you. So what if, you want to find a view with a particular ID or with particular text, a button you want to click on. First of all, you need to, locate the button. For that, we'll have the view matcher. And then, if you want to perform a particular action on a view, let's say you want to click it, right? So for that, we have view action. And then for assertion, checking if the button is displayed or not, for that, we have view assertion. So we look into detail, while seeing our test cases. So yeah, so this is, an Espresso test. So it's a class, it's a suit, which you can say. So if you see here, it's an activity test rule, which is to be written, while running your Espresso test cases. I won't go into more details of this because, it's a little detailed topic. I would give you, a brief of it. So yeah, so it defines how exactly your activity would open, right? So this is how we'll be opening the activity. And if you see the setup method, we are creating the data source. This fake data resource, we are creating the response, right? We are not putting the values in the response, but we are creating the blueprint of that response. So like this would be my list. So initially, what this line would do, it would create an empty, response of it. And later on, we'll add more details to it. So now let's, consider this, the very first test case of ours. On exception error, check if snack bar is displayed. The very first line, what it does is, so fake data source, like I showed you the method which created an observed line of code, right? There's no code to generate the data in my test code. Only one line of code, and the data source would give me the actual scenario. It'll give me the scenario here. It'll create a response for me with an exception. And now all I have to do is, I have to see whether the corresponding views are being seen, right? So yeah, so this is the assertion. So what I'm doing here is, First of all, no, just a minute. Yeah, so just, you know, consider this orange highlighted portion. What I'm doing is, I'm first of all finding the snack bar by ID, right? This is my, what you call, the viewfinder. So I'm finding the view, and then, you know, I'm checking whether the proper text is being displayed. So if you, you know, see this line over here, at the top of it, this one. So this is the text which should be displayed whenever an error comes, and this text should be displayed on the snack bar. So what I'm doing here is, you know, so I'm finding the snack bar with, you know, this text, the text, you know, which should be displayed on the snack bar, and then I'm checking, I'm asserting whether it should be displayed or not, whether it's being displayed or not, right? Yeah, so this is my view matcher. I'm finding the view, and then I'm checking, I'm asserting whether this condition is true or not. And then, you know, clicking a cancelled order. So, you know, just one line of code, and I've created an observable, you know, which will give me order statuses, you know, of all the three status type: cancelled order, order in processing, and another order. So only one line of code, and my entire scenario gets injected so that I can test it. So yeah, so I find an item which has text, you know, of order status cancelled, and I perform a click on it, and then I see whether on my next activity this text view should be displayed. So I'm checking whether this text view is getting displayed or not, right? Very straightforward. Yeah. And then, you know, testing server error, I create a data source, and then, you know, I find the snack bar, and then I check whether it's getting displayed or not. So let's talk about, you know, the time it took to run these test cases. It took around 49 seconds to run, you know, these six test cases. So 45 seconds, you know, was spent in building and installing the app, and 4 seconds, you know, got, you know, into running the test cases. So in total, it took us 49 seconds, you know, to run a test suite. Okay. So when to use Espresso? You know, when, you know, you want to go for integration testing, or when you want to test the UI first and the foremost. And also, if you want to go for a little end-to-end test approach, you can use Espresso for that as well. Okay, so the other approach which we have is Robolectric. And the magic of Robolectric is that it mocks the entire Android, you know, the Android SDK on Java virtual machine. It makes a shadow of it, such that you don't need an actual device to run your test cases. You can directly call the Android code and see whether it's behaving properly or not. And it fast because, you know, it runs directly on the JVM. No instrumentation, no device, actual device required for that. And let's see how it will happen. So like, as I told that Robolectric would be used for unit testing. So for unit testing, we have a different source set. Like for instrumentation, we had the folder Android test. For test, we would have a different folder test, right? And so here, like, as you can see, we'll have a different application, which will call the mocked modules and my tests. So, you know, let's dive into it. So like we had the test runner in case of instrumentation, we'll have a test runner here as well. And what this test runner is doing, it's using the unit test application. It won't use the actual application, it'll use the test application. And the test application, as you know, it will contain my fake modules, not the actual ones, right? So let's have a look at a test case, right? Yes, so this is a test. So first of all, you know, after every test, we'll be reloading, you know, the activity and, you know, reinitializing my views. Because the sole purpose of unit testing is that one test should not depend on another test. The testing should be done in isolation. That is the first and the foremost principle of unit testing. So as you can see here, the same test, you know, on exception error while fetching orders, I'm checking if the snack bar is displayed or not. And yeah, so one line of code, I'm creating the data source, I'm creating that entire scenario, and then, you know, I'm checking. So I get the text, and I'm seeing that So this shadow snack bar, this is my custom made snack bar using, you know, Robolectric code as well. So what we'll do is it's you know, checking whether a snack bar is displayed and whether that snack bar has that you know, text or not. Yeah. Okay, so I think we're running out of time. So so all the test cases would be the same. So it took us, you know, around 23 seconds to run our entire test suite, from 45 seconds to 23 seconds. So now we'll see, you know, okay, when to, so, you know, so any guesses how much time it took to, you know, run test cases? If I directly test the view model, how much time would it have been taken for me? Right, any guesses? So I think we're out of time, so I'll tell you the answer myself. It took 180 milliseconds to run the same test cases, right? So like from 45 seconds, we came to 23 seconds, and now we have come to 180 milliseconds. That is the magic of directly running, you know, directly testing your business logic. And so let's see it how. I think we have very little time for that. So like I told you about the view model, it's directly accepting, you know, the repository. And you know, it's parsing the response as per the contract. So this is the magic, you know, of data binding which is happening. So what data binding is doing is, you know, so this, you know, what is this? Yes, this progress bar, the visibility of this progress bar would depend, you know, on this observable boolean. It's not a normal boolean variable. It's an observable boolean, and that is being linked in my XML file itself. So whenever, you know, my observable boolean would change, automatically my view, you know, would get the information. And so this is what we call two-way data binding, right? And yeah, so that means, you know, you can directly test your view model and see whether the business logic works fine or not. And yeah, so it's very, very fast since it runs directly on your JVM and without, you know, having. So what Robolectric does is, you know, it converts. Some amount of time goes into, you know, converting that you know, Android specific code, you know, to Java code so that it can run on JVM. But since view model is simply a Java class, it will run directly on your JVM and the test would be very, very fast. So I think let me skip this because, you know, I have something else to, you know, tell you guys. It's, you know, it's quite similar what we did in case of Robolectric, the same thing. So what you're doing is, you know, we are instantiating an object of orders view model, you know, since it's a Java class, and then I'm asserting whether the view model, whether the method get orders list is giving me the correct response or not, right? So okay, so now that we are done, you know, with the unit testing and the correct approaches, now I'll tell you how to test on multiple devices, right? So you're done with your release. You know, you've tested on stage, tested on pre-pod, tested on 3 to 4 devices, and you're ready for the release. You make it live, you know. And especially if it's a Friday night, just to understand, yeah. So, and then, so, you know, on the Saturday morning, Crash Analytics, your fabric, it tells you, you know, investigation is recommended, right? On operating system 4 and 5, it's giving you crashes, especially on these phones. Right, so that is why something went wrong, something was not right. Although, you know, you gave your heart and soul, you worked very, very hard, you pushed yourself to meet the deadlines, but something went wrong, right? So that is why testing on multiple devices becomes very important. And what I'll tell you about is three approaches to do it. One is 5S Test Labs, one is Amazon Device Farm, and one is Sauce Labs. 5S Test Farm, you know, 5S Device Labs, you know, on your 5S account, you can, you know, run your instrumentation test cases, right? And you can also run it directly from the Android Studio and get very detailed reports. You can choose as many devices as the Firebase test device lab supports. And the only con of using Firebase test lab is, for example, you know, if, you know, you've written test cases in Appium. So, you know, many of the QA guys, they are, you know, in a habit of writing test cases in Appium. They would be a little bit reluctant to write test cases, you know, in Espresso. So Firebase Test Labs doesn't support Appium test cases or your TestNG test cases, right? So that is a con. And network speed throttling is not possible. So, you know, what if you want to test on low network? That won't be possible. So now let's talk about Amazon Device Farm. Amazon Device Farm, the biggest advantage is that it supports, you know, different test cases. your APM test cases would also run, right? APM test cases, you know, or your Calabash test cases, it will also support. And it will also support testing on low-end network devices. So 3G, you know, and all that stuff. And it will support, you know, APM test cases. Yes, that's for sure. And last, the last thing is, you know, source labs. So the only concern with, you know, APM is, the only con was that, for example, you know, APMs, you can create different test suits. So that test suit, it won't be able to run independently. It will run the entire, it will run all the tests for you. It won't run a particular test suit. That is the only disadvantage of Amazon Device Farm. But Source Labs, you know, there's no, you can, you know, test your APM, Robotium, and Espresso test cases. And yeah, so they've acquired this startup called Test Object, which will run your test cases on the real devices. And yeah, so all you have to do is, you just, instead of giving the link of your actual APM server, you're giving, you know, the link of the test server on Source Labs, and it'll run your test cases, right? And the only con is network speed throttling is not possible. You cannot test on low networks. So I think that is pretty much from my side. All in all, I would like to say is, oh Lord of test driven development, cast your light upon us, for the release is critical and prone to bugs. Thank you so much.